With the number one pick, the Philadelphia 76ers select the future world heavyweight champion of the world, Dean Ambrose. Welcome back to the second Box Score Geek show of the week, the second one with Andrew Sutton. We are talking the draft. I am your host, Dre Alvarez, a.k.a. Nerd Numbers. Maybe you're watching with us live. Basically, Brian decided to have a watch party for the NBA draft, and then while we're in the middle of downtime, we can discuss all sorts of other stuff. So as mentioned, again, we have our normal comment expert, Andrew Sutton, on the show. Andrew, say hey.
Hey, what's up, man?
And how you feeling? Ben Simmons just got selected with the number one pick. You good?
Yeah, that's a great decision. I wish Hinkie was still here to see it.
Have you seen this? This gets the preemptive shout out. I don't even think there are going to be shout outs on the show, Brian. I haven't had anything prepared. But there was a fan, I guess, in either the draft audience or somewhere that was holding up a sign that said, "Hinkie died for your sins." All right, sorry. Because we started a little late, I forgot to introduce our producer, Brian Foster, our own voice of God. Brian, say hey.
What's up, guys? And yeah, it's going to be fun. You know, I got my beer. We're going to talk some NBA. And, you know, yeah, I'm like you, Dre. I haven't been getting into the draft as much the last few weeks. But now that it's here, I don't know. I'm pretty excited. I want to see the Warriors get another Kevon Looney at the 30th pick. And we've got kind of some general draft stuff to talk about, too. And, of course, there's been trades recently. We'll talk some trades and probably
plenty
more trades.
We have plenty to discuss that, but hopefully in 3 seconds we'll be getting the news. I hope myself and Andrew, if you listen to our show this week, we're hoping for. The Lakers are on the clock, according to I'm watching live on CBSSports.com. Another asset I would tell anybody if you're watching along, you got to go to Draft Express. They have... they're the easiest way to look up stuff. And anyway, that's weird.
The pick is in, guys, for the Lakers.
All right, so we got 5 minutes before the next pick. As I mentioned, you really need to look at draftexpress.com if you haven't. We got some basic numbers up at the site today, courtesy of David Barry. So if you go to boxscoregeeks.com and are watching along live, even in the future, we have an article called NBA Draft Prospects Wins Produced. So let's talk a little bit about this recent pick because we've bashed it preemptively. According to Dave Barry's numbers, if you're looking at like the top 100 draft prospects at NBA.com, Brandon Ingram last season was an above-average player. He had a wins per 48 of 0.122. An average player has a wins per 48 of 0.1. But if we compare that to, for instance, Ben Simmons had a wins per 48 of 300, three times as good as average. So what do you think, Andrew? This pick, you already just showed.
Isn't David Barry's college WP numbers different? I mean, average-wise, isn't like ratcheted up a little bit, like 1.50?
I don't think for
sure. I saw a tweet that he said like 6 of the 13 lottery picks were below average, and I was like, well, Ingram's probably one of those guys.
No, I don't know if he ratchets it up or whatever. But the other thing to consider about college, it's much different than the NBA. I put this in the article, is that, you know, in college, there's no real normalization of your strength of schedule. In the NBA, even the toughest strength of schedule team still has to play the Warriors, still gets to play the 76ers. In college, there's no such thing. So, I mean, what we can say to Brandon Ingram is because he went to Duke, he did have decent competition. And he is a freshman, so there's a lot going for there. But it is a little shocking to me to see him go this high. Not based on, you know, all the buzz. But I'm saying if you're looking at advanced stats, to put that in quotes or somewhat facetiously, this is a little, you know, it's funny. It shows that the draft still isn't solved.
I think his only, like, redeeming skill is he's a good three-point shooter.
And the rough part about three-point shooting...
Well,
it's not even that it's noisy. There's a great article by Kevin Broom over at Vice Sports today, Brian, if you look that up in the background.
Oh, yeah, we have it up.
Yeah, I read that. Good article.
So he doesn't mention three-point shooting, and I think the important thing to remember about three-point shooting in college versus the NBA is it's a shorter line. So shooting 41% from three in college, that's a good indicator. You're absolutely right. That's a good start. But the issue we run into is the NBA three-point line is further out, and, you know, There are a lot of people in the, you know, in college who are good three-point shooters. They come into the NBA and they shoot mid-range shots because they've basically been getting trained for the last, you know, 1 to 3 years to shoot mid-range jumpers in the NBA, not three-pointers.
And I think also with him going to the Lakers, they're going to give him way too many minutes. I think that's a detriment in terms of development.
Yeah, it's. I love that point. If you look at last season, there are some highly touted prospects. Unfortunately, one was on the Nuggets. So, you know, you have Jahlil Okafor, D'Angelo, and Moutier. And yeah, they all did. They were horrible. I mean, D'Angelo Russell and Moutier were horrible. And I think a big problem with that is basically that, yeah, they were given the team as, you know, essentially a sophomore in college. And, you know, there are a lot of these players that, you know, couldn't even be the leader of their team as a sophomore in college, much let alone the NBA.
Yeah, like if you're in school for the first day of school, you don't just throw out the trigonometry the first day. You gradually go up. You gradually go up. And there's no priors. So how would you know that he's adept at playing NBA basketball? There's no priors. He's never played NBA basketball.
And guys, one thing that Patrick all says, who's the guy who's got the coaching experience out of us, is that you need good players to practice against. So when these young players go to these really bad teams, there's no one better player than them to make them better, if that makes any sense.
By the way, let's point out a few things about Ingram that are still positive. He's 6'9" with a 7'3" wingspan. He's very young. He can clearly play tall. One thing that I think we want to be really, really careful about in this draft, and this is like straight from Dave Barry. Every year I kind of talk the draft with Dave Barry, and every year he kind of says, don't make predictions. And the basic point we should make is the salaries already. By the time we're down to the third pick, I don't have this up in front of me readily, but Brian, I think Wikipedia's got a good article on it. The pay scale is so ludicrous for the first round that you're not losing out. You know, the Lakers are paying less than a mid-level exception for Brandon Ingram, which means
Well, in terms of ROI, it's just, I don't know. That's kind of steep to pay him $6 million.
But he's not. He's getting like four. Or, and it might be up to six, but that's with the salary cap going up.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think with the salary cap jump, it's a little bit more.
But I mean, I'm just saying, you really can't lose out in the draft. The only way you can lose out, you already made this point once this week, Andrew, on the earlier show this week.
Yeah,
you guys need to stop listening to this show. Go listen to the first podcast of the week instead of watching the draft. Clearly, the right move. But the first 2 years and the major problem teams have is they're not willing to cut the cord, right? If D'Angelo Russell sucks after next season, the Lakers would do well to either trade him or let him go. And odds are they're still going. Whoever has D'Angelo Russell next season, because I hear the Kings are targeting him, and I really hope that happens. I really hope the Kings.
Let me ask you guys this though. So a kind of a related thing. So the guy who is at the very top of this list, let's bring it up here. Now, to be fair, this is the wins produced for college basketball. This is not a full draft projection
model. And giving you a head up, Brian, we may be cutting you off in a second because the Celtics pick is in. I'm not watching this live on TV. I'm watching at CBS Sports that does have a live track. So let's see who was selected. Why, I cut you off preemptively.
It hasn't been picked yet.
They're in the war room, though. They're in the Celtics war room. So just to finish this point off real fast, though, a guy who is at the very top of the wins produced list, and this doesn't factor in height and age and all this stuff, but just what they did in college, right, which we think is very important for the pros. You better dominate in college if you're going to be good in the pros. Kyle Collinsworth of Brigham Young, right, the triple-double machine, he had amazing stats in college. And I was tweeting around, or, you know, I'm sounding kind of old when I say that, but a little earlier today with Arturo and longtime Wages of Wins commenter Julian Roger. And I said, wow, this Collinsworth guy was a triple-double machine. And the point came up, well, but he's really old. You know, he's a Mormon. He went on his mission. So let me ask you, so I think you're going to agree with me here, Andrew, all you care about is the rookie deal, right? So if you can get an older rookie who's in his prime during the rookie deal, isn't that a great deal for your team? Like, what do you guys think about older versus younger players?
Stay in the present. I think teams should stay in the present more. Stop looking at the long view so much, because that potential is basically an empty cup. You don't know how much is going to get filled in that cup, and I don't know.
You would go for the Mormon Russell Westbrook then. You would take him.
I wouldn't take him that high, though.
Oh, okay.
You gotta realize this is a draft, and you can game that system.
Yeah.
You can trade down. I mean, one of the best
drafts. Oh, that's a good point.
One of the best trades in NBA draft history was for Penny Hardaway, which did this exact thing, which is they traded the number one pick for the number two pick, and then not only that, then they got, I think, three future draft picks out of it. So it's kind of like, yeah, if the market isn't willing to pay for it, this is, I think, the same thing I've said about like Kenneth Faried a lot. I am the biggest Kevin Faried fan out there, but I don't
pick.
Okay, what do we got?
Jaylen Brown. Wow.
Isn't that your boy?
That's
no.
Also, Wilbon loves him, though. Look at this. Look at these old guys talking.
He's from Georgia, so I've watched him play high school basketball. So, yeah.
From the same high school as Sharif Abdurrahim, is that right? Maybe? Maybe not. Anyway,
so
we talked about Jaylen Brown on Tuesday. He's supposed to be a really good guy. He's really young. And so maybe he'll do well, but his numbers were just really bad in college. Really, really bad.
According to Dave Barry's numbers, and sorry to cut you off, I'll let you finish in just a sec. According to Dave Barry's numbers that we put up at the Box Score Geek show today, he is the second worst prospect on the list of NBA prospects, just in front of, I don't know if it's Danielle or Daniel, Daniel House from Texas A&M.
Daniel House.
Daniel. Yeah. All right. Okay, so finish up your thoughts. Sorry to cut you off there, Andrew.
No, I was going to say, at least he's young. Hey.
He is young. He's got a big he doesn't have a great wingspan. It's like 6'7", and he's I got nothing. I got nothing here. Maybe if they trade him, and I'm gonna go over to Draft Express and do the same thing that I mentioned, is take a look and see if there's anything redeeming that I can say about.
There's been some rumors that the Bulls are in Boston are in talks possibly with Jimmy Butler, but I don't think. That pick isn't less valuable now because they've taken it.
Yeah. Guys, I hate to say this, but we've got the spreadsheet up here of all the players, and he is like the fifth or sixth ranked Jaylen in wins produced. He is 1,961 in wins produced. To put that in perspective, Brandon Ingram was 400th. So Jaylen Brown just didn't produce any box score stats, and he shot a low percentage on a high volume of shots. So, sorry, Jaylen Brown. I really hope you do well. You're supposed to be a good guy. Go Bears.
I'm sorry. I'm tweeting out. I said, box score Brian says Jaylen Brown isn't even the best Jaylen available.
No, I had to go through a lot of Jaylens before
and
I found
him. And Jaylen's another guy who had, like, people don't like his character. They think he might be too intellectual, that's just dumb. they question his love for the game. So,
give me a break.
Which is stupid. So they said the same thing about Willie Cauley-Stein last season, and look how that turned out.
Yeah.
What's fascinating to me about the intellectual, there actually is kind of something there, which is to say, players that kind of overthink can be rough, and some of the better players are the ones that, you know, just kind of have a rhythm routine. One of our friends of the show, Art Rondeau, he basically kind of talks about, you know, training people for shooting. And that is, you know, you get them in a mental zone, you get them in routines, you get them in rhythms. So players that overthink, I mean, the issue I would really have more here, it's not the cerebral, it's not the attitude. We're so funny on this. It's production. It's,
yeah.
I think I'm quoting you back to you, Andrew, but one of the things that's annoying is, you know, it's certainly reasonable to think that a player that dominates college, that, you know, a senior at a weak school, you know, that should be dominating, that's Kyle Collinsworth is what we're talking. There is reason to say, hey, we don't necessarily think he'll dominate the NBA the same way he dominated college. But why do people take players that did horrible in college? And I'm looking at this. I'm looking at Draft Express over here, and, you know, it's actually a real warning sign to me to have anybody in college shoot under 30% from three, because the line's shorter. He took 3 points. He took 3 three-pointers a game and connected on 29.4% of them. That's a little troubling.
But like I said in last show, is that recruiting stuff matters a lot too. It impacts draft position, I think, because he's still living off that high school reputation, because he was like in the top five.
Yep, absolutely.
Well, so one of the things that we've discussed, I'll see if I can.
Did they even make the tournament?
They did. They made it to the second. They got destroyed by Hawaii in the first round. That's what happened.
See?
And actually, a player on Hawaii, Yankovic, is rated pretty highly in wins produced. So we'll see where he ends up going.
He's not getting drafted.
Oh, boy. UFAs, look out for him.
Let's give a little credit to Jaylen Brown. Selected number 3 in the draft, and let's be honest, it's been ridiculous. But Ben Simmons and Brandon Ingram have been the de facto one and two. You know, the comparison you might hear, which I'm going to love, is Durant and Oden, right? Which could be funny. But, you know, they've been the de facto one and two. So he got the highest draft pick available, and he did it without an agent. We mentioned that before. So, you know, let's get into this a little, Andrew, because you brought this up right at the end of last show. And if I have to cut you off because the draft comes through, but we'll finish this topic, is, you know, the draft is a very weird and kind of messed up system where we don't like it a lot for a variety of reasons. Somebody's going to be forced to go to the Kings. No one wants to go to the Kings. But, you know, we got to give Jalen credit for getting
hey,
paid.
Hey, Dre, Northern California is great, all right.
But the argument that likes to be made is that if there's no draft, everyone want to play for the Lakers, which is not true. There's money involved, so I think players, I think that will work. The market will work itself out.
Yeah, I mean, people, it's so funny to your point there that nobody recognizes that we have tons of systems where there aren't drafts already. You know, every MIT and Stanford software developer doesn't end up at Google. Even the top ones, even the top of the class, you know, Google doesn't draft, I'll put that in quotes, you know, the first through 20th ranked in their class software engineers out of Stanford. There's money concerns, there's lifestyle concerns, there's all sorts of other stuff. So it's so ridiculous to think of the NBA, it would work that way. And, you know, additionally, we're at the point where the NBA has never been fair. So I don't know why people are so terrified that the dominant teams are going to keep dominating. You know, we just saw a repeat of the NBA finals, and that's nothing new. It's completely possible. We'll see the exact same team. Thanks, dog. We'll see the exact same team in the NBA finals 3 years in a row. I just said thanks, dog, by the way, if you're just an audio only listener.
Yeah, your shoulder's off the camera now, Dre, but we're fine.
My dog Moby, not Kobe. Moby was underneath my desk, and he just got up and then knocked the camera. So I'm going to turn my camera off and readjust it. Andrew, sorry to cut you off again.
Look at college. The same team seemed to win year, like historically. So I mean, it doesn't affect that level. That level at all.
So it's so weird, and I mean I really like
or soccer point. Or soccer overseas, the Premier
League.
Yeah,
it's like European soccer, right? That's the free market system works pretty well for them.
Yeah,
high school sports, they're popular. A guy can transfer, like, he doesn't have to sit out; he can just go to another school. It's I don't know. The NBA is already exploitative enough without having to have this slave auction.
Yeah, that was actually what I wanted to get you to, is that it just feels very weird. I've never really watched the Combine. I just get the advantage that all of that data is at Draft Express. If you go to Draft Express, you can notice that I can find the height, the weight, the age, the wingspan.
Dragan,
you
know, Bender goes to Phoenix.
Oh, here we go. Well, I guess the good news, you mentioned Arturo earlier. Arturo has been bashing this player.
Big time.
For a while now, and so... You know, it's good he didn't end up on the Celtics. I still don't think the Celtics won. But let's talk about anything to say about Dragan Bender. I don't know a lot. He's international, so I'm going to try and look up his international.
Yeah, so Arturo,
Young. He's really young. And, I mean, Arturo didn't really care for Porzingis that much last season. Well, he likes Porzingis' prospects more than his, so that's even damning enough.
Well, yeah, so there's a few things about international players. Like, first of all, They tend to be younger in their pro performances, right? So they're playing behind older players. So they don't really small sample size on minutes, right? It's hard. So that's one thing. But number two on Bender is that Arturo says that his stats are terrible in the minutes he did play. So what he basically said, this is a works picked at Exum.
Well,
and
here's
I
got to fight back on this.
Okay,
but
good.
That's damning too. If you're gonna go off small sample size and take a guy at four.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm looking at his numbers. In the Euro Cup this season, he basically played between the two, the Euro League and the Euro Cup, he played 10 games and played less than 11 minutes per game. As we pointed out, he's 18 years old. He was 1997. This guy's not even old enough to remember the Dream Team. Jeez.
But his name is Dragan Bender. That's the best name in the draft, guys. You have to take him just for that.
One thing we say is you can't teach height. He's a 7'1", 18-year-old. And you know what? I think the important thing to kind of go for here, the important thing to go for here in the draft, and we've said this over and over and over again, is you're not drafting for need. This is what the Kevin Broome article that I brought up. If you expect the player you draft this season to impact your team this season, you are fooling yourself. That is so rare that it happens, and usually it happens on a team that's so far removed from the playoffs it doesn't matter. You know, Karl-Anthony Towns did great last season, but that didn't matter. It meant absolutely nothing to the T-Wolves other than letting them know they were right for that pick. So, you know, Dragon Bender, the Dragon Bender, I love it. You know, that's got to be his nickname on the show forever. The Dragon Bender up there with the Airbender. You know, if he develops in a couple of seasons, they can keep him around for nothing. And if he doesn't, they let him go. And candidly, I don't hate that idea as a pick.
I don't know.
Well, so here's the way I look at it. Like, okay, so I have this list of draft principles on our script here. And the first one is that you expect to fail, right? That, Dre, I think you said on Tuesday you expect only 3 stars per draft, right, of the whole draft.
I would maybe say, I think we've done this before, and I apologize. I didn't get this ready.
I would say 2.
Yeah,
two.
I think, actually, Andrew, I think you're right. Yeah, you've read all of Patrick's articles, too. Patrick did one of those where he, like, went through every draft and said, here are all the star players that came through. And it's, like, 2, and usually one of them was, like, a prospect that you could have argued was foreseeable. In some cases, it's a top 3 pick. In other cases, it is a lottery pick. And the other one, you usually have no idea, right? You know, we got players like Paul Millsap in the second round, Draymond Green in the second round, Rajon Rondo end of the first round. So you're expecting about 2 stars a draft, and even more importantly, a lot of times those stars don't show up for a season or two.
Yeah, so my only point in bringing that up is you expect to fail. Like, your draft pick is overwhelmingly probably going to be a bust. So why not take a guy that you have some data on that actually has produced in some league like the NCAA or some good European league? Why not increase those odds just a little bit? I don't know.
That's how I look at it. I tend to look at it from, like, a gambler's approach.
Yeah.
I tend to look at it like that. So if a guy has had, like, a couple of seasons in the NCAA, then I like his prospects more than a guy that did 1 year and he was okay, but he was young and scouts like young guys and tall guys. So
I candidly have no real complaints going for, if you're going to do it, we've said this before, if you're going to go for a person that doesn't have the numbers, you damn well better be going for a big with a big arm span that's young. If you know, I have no problem with this pick because of that. But, you know, for instance, we just talked about Jaylen Brown, who, you know, I think he may be my new favorite player just because.
But you better give up when it's time to give up.
Yeah. And that's the question. In 2 years, if he's still in Phoenix in 2 years and not producing, will they give up? And, you know, Darko Milicic is an example of what I love about Darko Milicic is the cautionary tale of a draft bust is how many contracts above $5 million a year did Darko end up with before he finally washed out?
Too many. Keep getting them checks.
I'm looking that up right now.
Keep getting them checks.
He is tall, though. We were just showing the draft on screen here. The reporter could barely reach the mic up to his face. So I'll give him that much. But I don't know. Do we want to go over any more of these draft principles while we're between picks here?
Let's see. How much time do we got before? The Timberwolves are close, so I'll start. Here's
away.
One thing. I want to get you guys' opinion on this. This was awesome. We've had 3 major trades in the last week, I'd argue, and I use the word major. I use it. I'll put it that way. I get to use that word. But we got to see Derrick Rose finally leave the Bulls, end of an era, I guess. We got to see Bellinelli leave the Kings, and we got to see Thad Young. Where did Thad Young end up?
Pacers.
He went to the Pacers. And the Pacers also traded George Hill for Jeff Teague. I don't know what the Pacers are doing right now. I'm not going to lie. It's a little odd.
Their backcourt is going to be Jeff Teague and Monte Ellis.
Ugh.
That's not good.
Wait, I'm very confused because from the perspective of Utah, the reason Utah traded, was it Utah ended up with George Hill?
Yeah.
Yes.
I could see Utah going for George Hill because they said we need a better distributor.
It was good for them, yeah.
I would have assumed that if you were getting Jeff, if you're getting Jeff Teague, you needed a shooter at your point guard and they've got Monte Ellis. That's bizarre.
And then my home team is just they love Schroeder for some reason. I don't know why they love Schroeder, but
So what is your home team again?
Atlanta.
I mean, what's interesting about Atlanta? I have a few funny things. I've actually liked their moves mostly recently, although this is odd.
Their future is pretty good.
So what did they end up with in that trade? So
the 12th pick.
Oh, all right. Well, we'll have to see what they do with that. But I actually don't have a problem getting rid of Jeff Teague for the 12th pick is fine. I think I think Indiana lost that trade. I think that was a great trade for
getting
Utah.
Getting rid of Jeff Teague is good, yes. But they damn well better find a point guard in the free agency, because Schroeder is not the guy we want starting.
Yeah.
Well, one of the fascinating things to me about point guards that's so baffling is
Chris Dunn going to Minnesota.
All right, so what do we think of this? We should take a look real quick.
That's actually a good pick, but I don't think they should have went for a point guard.
Interesting.
I think there's better talent available. If we want to be economical about it, I think there's better talent available. We're going to go for best available, which I'm a fan of going for best available.
So
there's better talent left on the board.
Who would you have gone for if you had their pick?
I think they need some backup big, so I would have probably went with Sabonis.
Yeah,
I was gonna ask that. Sabonis, is he related to the other Sabonis?
Oh, Dre, you're going robot. Let's see if we can get you back here.
That's his son.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Okay. I'm gonna turn off my camera, Brian. That helps with the bandwidth, I think.
Okay.
So going off. Audio listeners won't care. Oh, yeah, I didn't realize he was son. That's awesome. I mean, I would love to see another Steph Del Curry, you know, fight in the NBA. So. Wherever it's Thomas, is that how you say it? Thomas?
Yeah, I think that might be a nickname. It might be Donatus. Anyway, yeah, it's
DeMontis. Yeah, DeMontis.
DeMontis, there we go. Yeah. DeMontis. So, now that's interesting. So, here's another one of our draft principles is that rebounding is the stat that carries over the best from college to the pros. And he was a really good rebounder in college. And he, you know, played in the tournament and all that. So, he's a guy that I think someone kind of in the mid to late first round. Yeah, like you said, Andrew, it's going to get a good value on. And yeah, I'll also say Chris Dunn, we have as the 37th highest wins produced player on Dave Barry's list. So that's not terrible compared to some of these picks, but still they could have maybe done better.
I think that might be a sign that they might be wanting to get rid of Rubio.
Oh, that's bad. Not.
If you take a point guard this high, I think they, and then they've already in talks with Chicago and stuff. So
shield your ears, Patrick. Shield your ears.
I think that might be taking a step back if they trade Rubio, because there's going to be a learning curve.
Yeah. Well, here's what always bugs me about the trading for Young is, as soon as you hit the wins per 48 of about 0.2, and with major minutes, right? So you've got a player that's about 2,000 minutes and a 0.2 wins per 48. The idea that you are ever going to be able to trade Young for that type of player, for that caliber of player, is just almost minuscule. I mean, one thing that we should point out is, for as much love as we give Karl Anthony Towns, I think he ranks like sixth in centers this last season. I mean, he was an astounding rookie. He was an above average player. Not even sixth. Like he's top 10, but he's like the ninth best center in the league. So when you trade, you know, one of the top point guards in the league, and I think we do consider Rubio that, Rubio is top 15 maybe.
So we've got an update from Above the Gods in chat here. He's saying that Dunn's going to probably get traded maybe to the Bulls, so we'll see what happens. This is all Mark Stein reporting, it looks like.
So, I mean, that's another thing that gets interesting is in other sports, it's legal to trade up or trade down. You can't quite do that in the NBA if you don't have a deal ahead of time. So what you're basically allowed to proxy pick for another team if you would like to. And so we don't know any of these things that are going on behind the scenes. This happened last year one of the years Arturo and I live drafted, where we were confused at the 76ers pick and then they traded for Nerlens Noel. So we'll see if any of that happens.
Now that's interesting. And we've also got from Wad share coming up. Looks like Buddy Hield is going sixth.
And then he's not, the thing about Dunn, he's not young. He's basically a senior age player. So we have more data on him. So I think it's a good pick, but there's, like I said, there's more talent available. Better talent available, I should say.
I mean, what's interesting, and you've got the positions a little better. Maybe I should have done their listed positions. Because one thing that Dave does is he you know, he does a position adjustment and he goes by height and weight. So college is a lot different than the NBA because, you know, you can have a player that's listed as a point guard, but, you know, they're 6'8 and over 200 pounds. But so Buddy Hield, you know, he's a senior. His wins per 48 in college was a 0.19. I don't know how strong Oklahoma's strength of schedule is. Apologies, I am not a big college fan. But yeah, I mean, even to your point, Kyle Collinsworth, right, is much better. So the question is, do you think that Buddy Hield's, you know, strength of competition was twice as good as Collinsworth? And we'll just have to see.
Yeah, that's one of those unquantifiable things. People like to do the strength of schedule. But, I mean, if you legit, just from like a gambler's perspective, once again, good teams tend to beat bad teams, but good teams also tend to lose to other good teams. So, I mean, strength of schedule is just basic. I'm weary about strength of schedule metrics.
Well, I don't mind the strength of schedule metrics, but kind of to your point is, it's kind of unforgivable at any level in college for you not to dominate the competition because, you know, we get this argument every year, right? The 76ers. 76ers last year, you are fooling yourselves. You can take the last three NCAA title teams. They would get smoked by the 76ers in a best of seven series. I'm sorry. And the 76ers suck. They're horrible. the level of caliber of player in the NBA is so much better than NCAA. And so if you are not dominating the NCAA, which is like one reason we're kind of, you know, skeptical of Brandon Ingram, if you're a team picking a player like that, you better have a reason. So, for instance, we don't know this. This is hypothesis. But, you know, Andre Drummond, we didn't really care much for, but he's a big player and he's young. And you might argue, well, maybe he just didn't care in college. Maybe he didn't try hard. Maybe we think we can get him to try hard. But to be fair, every team seems convinced that they're going to be able to change a player's attitudes and change a player's bad habits. And it happens so rarely that, you know, it's one of those, why don't you just go for a player that's already productive?
I have two things on Buddy Hield. Two negative things. Well,
all right. What do we got?
He's already the age of an NBA pro, and his career numbers aren't as good as his last 2 years. I think he's really just bullying college players because of his age. Those last 2 years.
And I'm trying to live tweet some of our comments. So, sorry. Go ahead.
And he goes to New Orleans. New Orleans just picked him.
So I'm trying to live tweet some of our stuff. So what I'm going to say for you is Buddy Hield is already as old as an NBA pro, and his numbers have declined. I'm gonna put this out for you, Andrew. Is this okay to put this out on Twitter? Andrew is skeptical. The Twitterverse is going to know your opinion. So if they come after me, I'm gonna send them your way.
So Drain Andrew, we have him here on the spreadsheet as the 63rd highest win producing player out of everyone in college. And on top of that, this is total wins, not WP48, which he's much lower in because he played a lot of minutes, right? And Dre, I have even worse news. Waj is reporting the next pick too. Your Denver Nuggets. Do you want to get that spoiled for you right now?
You just said bad news, so I'm assuming they're picking someone's question. So who do we got?
They are picking. He's not even the best Murray here. He is the second best Murray, Jamal Murray, out of Kentucky, 339th. On the list with a 0.12 WP40. So again, that's in a lot of minutes. He's probably a little bit even lower than that, maybe down to the 400s if you're talking per 40 minutes. However, he is a freshman. He is young, so you've got that going for him.
And his position too. You have to think about it. He might be a little bit better because he's going to be playing a smaller position. Because I think he played like the 3 in college.
This is one, and by the way, bringing back, we've been doing drafts for a couple of years now, and what's funny is you talked about declining numbers recently, Andrew. I got to admit, year after year, my level of interest and my level in the draft has just dropped where, you know, I've kind of gone, you know, first year worked with Arturo a lot, tried to help get data for models and talked to Dave and looked at Combine. And, you know, this year you could see like basically the day before the draft, I did a trade with Dave Barry and I actually need to finish that where I offered to trade him some NCAA data for his NCAA data. I still haven't gotten him that data. So Dave lost that trade so far.
Future considerations, I guess, Dre.
Future considerations, I guess. But yeah, so anyway, you know, he gave me his numbers and I put them up on the site. That's as much. And skeptical of listening to overall message about the draft is, it's mostly random and most of these players aren't going to matter. I couldn't quite get this into words today, but I wanted to make a tweet that was something like, I can say with 90% certainty that your draft pick won't matter to all the teams in the NBA draft. And actually, that is pretty good, I might say it. But I'm looking at Jamal Murray, and sorry, to get back to the original point of the tangent, we've been doing this for years. One point Arturo has made in the past, and I don't know how much I agree with this, but is when you have super teams in college, we've said this forever, there's only one ball, there's only so many minutes, that some players' values do get depressed. So what I'll give Jamal Murray is he's above average, he's young, he's relatively tall, not relatively tall, he's got a big wingspan for his height. He's like 6'3", 6'5", but he's got like a 6'7", 6'8", wingspan. So maybe we'll see. I don't hate it. I will say what's interesting about the Nuggets is you pointed out to me, Andrew, how did you know this, that Lane Vashrow got a job there? How did you hear about that?
I think I saw that on Twitter. Even though I don't have a Twitter, I do follow a lot. I think I saw that on Twitter. A lot of those nylon calculus guys are getting like NBA jobs, and it's funny how I'm reading all about these models and stuff, but it's only 30% at most you can predict with this stuff, with those models.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly like the nylon calculus guys. And Lane Vashrow is one that I'll give a ton of credit for. We loved his model. We were lucky. We got right under the wire. There's an old Box Score Geek show with him on the show. We were
about
so lucky.
A year ago, right, Dre? Right before the draft last year.
Yeah, and I mean, and right after that, he went radio. All of his tweets are gone. All of his models are off the net. We got him right before he went radio silent, so that was lucky for us.
He was an awesome guest. If they're smart, they'll put him in front of the camera because he's an awesome guy.
Seth Partnow's with Milwaukee.
Yeah. The Bucks. Yeah, I heard that. Well, I mean, what I was going to say is I like a lot of the guys, but I'm not going to avoid being a little mean. I find their work decent, but I'm very surprised at the number of people that are doing stats where I can see very simple mistakes. Regression analysis is an example where a bunch of people, hobbyists, use regression analysis and a bunch of them make mistakes. And nylon calculus, you know, there's a metric called Dre that has problems. I'm surprised at the number of people that get jobs where I go, you know, it's not that I don't think they're smart. It's not that I don't think they're intelligent. I'm very baffled that, you know, they're the people that get jobs. And it seems like NBA teams do like going for talkers. They definitely like lawyers, is what it is.
I think they get too stuck on predictive analysis. And it's just, this stuff is so hard to predict. But if they show some shiny numbers and some charts, and I think NBA teams will just like, well, he seems like he knows some stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because what happened when the Bulls traded away, we did not. I guess we can wait till it's official. But you know, when the Bulls traded away Derrick Rose, you know, even Arturo was saying, well, they got a plan. They're clearing the books next season. They got a plan. And I am so sick. I'm sorry. I'm going to go off on a little bit of a tirade here. Whoa. I am so sick of people defending teams because they have a plan when the plan is stupid. The Bulls traded away their two best players who is expiring this season. If the Bulls want to clear cap space, it is so much easier than basically giving up the season. And in the NBA, I want to be 100% clear on this. I am never, ever, 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 ever behind giving up an NBA season preemptively. That's my definition of tanking. I am never for giving up an NBA season preemptively with the hopes that things will get better. Don't forget, the Knicks were the prime. I put that kind of facetiously, but they were. There was a point in NBA history where everybody thought LeBron James was going to the Knicks. That wasn't the last one. That was the decision. Everybody thought he was going to end up on the Knicks in the decision, and he didn't. And they ended up with Amari Stoudemire. You can have a plan. You can say we're going to clear the books to get LeBron James. You can say we're going to clear the books so that next season we can get Kevin Durant and Kevin Love, Kevin Durant and LeBron James, whatever, right? But when it doesn't happen, I am allowed to mock you, and I'm allowed to mock you if you do stupid stuff preemptively. So I'm so sick of people defending NBA teams because they have a plan. Just because you have a plan, that's no more special than picking randomly, because we've seen NBA teams that are essentially random luck into wins. You know, the Minnesota Timberwolves, for as defunct as they are, there was a point in NBA history where they were the favorites to go to the finals before being upset by the Lakers.
Yeah, I agree. I look at the European model, basically. It's win now, win now, win now. It's not, okay, we're going to throw this season away for next season. That's dumb. because you in European soccer field, you can get relegated. So there's a risk there if you want to just throw away everything.
Yeah, and I mean that's what's kind of funny is the draft. They've done a good job, interestingly enough. They've actually done a good job of disincentivizing teams to tank. People don't realize this, right? You're the worst team in the NBA. You only have a 25% shot at the number one pick, and you only have a guarantee of a top four pick. And, you know, we've seen this, where they've done all of these changes to the NBA draft to disincentivize tanking. And I think the reason it is still so pervasive is that it gives teams an out. If you are a bad front office, if you go up to your manager and you say, look, we clearly just suck. We traded for Thaddeus Young and Jeff Teague. Yes, that is a shot at you, Atlanta. You are better than this. Give me a break.
He went to
Indiana. I meant to say
Indiana. Yeah, and for a 20th pick, like, he's not a bad player. I don't think that's the worst trade in the world.
No, that's a horror. We can.
You
get
don't
on
like that.
That?
Okay, well, keep going. And Jamal Murray is now officially picked by the Nuggets.
All right, so
he was the ESPN number one player on the board, Dre. So you must like this pick.
About I was gonna add something onto that 25% number one to teams tanking for that 25%. And if you think about it, the way the NBA teams pick, the odds of you getting the best player in that draft are against you.
Oh, absolutely.
So I think that's so ironic that they do all of that work to lose to get the best spot, but they don't end up getting the best player.
Oh, yeah, because as you pointed out, your odds are only 1 in 4 that you get the number one pick. And that's, you know, years like Carl Anthony Towns or Blake Griffin, where they are the number one player. But so many years we see, you know, Kawhi is the best player in his draft. Chris Paul picked 4th is the best player in his draft. So, yeah, I agree. Like, just you keep talking about viewing this as a gambler, about viewing this probabilistically. And that's important to go, if I tank, my odds are like 8% maybe of getting a best player in the draft, and more importantly, there is not a guarantee that that best player in the draft is transcendent, right? You know, even Blake Griffin and Greg Oden, these are two players that everybody thought were great, and they both did play great, but because of injuries, both of them may end their career as basically being good but not great players. So we'll have to see. All right, so Brian, let's talk Jamal Murray. I'm not going to lie, I'm taking off my glasses. I turned off my camera so you can't see that, but I'm taking off my glasses and putting back on my Nuggets fan glasses. Let's take a look at the numbers. I'm at Draft Express for Jamal Murray. A few things that I'll point out that are good. His two-point percentage is above 50%. His three-point percentage is above 40%. His free throw, average, basically, 78%. His rebounds, decent. I mean, he's a point guard, shooting guard. So his rebounds for a small are pretty good. It looks like he's mostly been playing shooting guard. So the one area that I'm worried about is his assist to turnovers. For those of you wondering why I'm suddenly all interested in the stats, and for like even for the top picks like Ingram, I was like, whatever, they're just going to be whatever. It's because I'm a Nuggets fan. I'm sorry. I admit it. I have my biases. There we go. I don't hate this pick. And I give a little credit to Lane Vasherow, because I do have some faith in him. And Kentucky, you know, the Nuggets do have ties with Kentucky because of Brett Barrett. So I don't hate this pick. He's the second best player on Kentucky. There's a lot to be said there. The point you're making about Arturo is that super teams sometimes do seem to decrease the stats of good players. So this the same thing we've been saying all show. This isn't a lose. He's an above average player in the NBA and he's young. That said, I'm going to actually have to agree with you, Andrew. I don't necessarily think he's the best player, but then the flip side, because I keep flip-flopping, as we were all pointing out, he was the top of the draft list. So if you're looking at, you know, spending the pick wisely, their choices would be take the best player available that everybody thinks is the best player, and then, you know, that's an asset, or trade down. So
yeah, I was going to say, if you want him, I think you could trade down some spots to get him.
Not to get Jamal Murray, right? I mean, he was already picked and he was the top of the thing. So, I mean,
yeah. I mean, I was saying beforehand, but yeah, I agree.
So nothing exciting there. Any devil's advocate out of you, Brian?
No, I mean, again, we're talking about the gambler's mentality, so I agree with all that. But I will say that Wojnarowski is reporting Phoenix has traded up for the 8th pick into the King spot. It's been rumored that Eric Bledsoe is on the move, so hopefully they didn't make that trade, but we'll see what happens there.
Well, what's fascinating about that, if that does happen, is one, Eric Bledsoe has been their best player 2 years in a row, but he was out injured all of the second half of last season. So the question there is, that means if he's getting moved, he has to have passed a physical. So that's a, that's an interesting question, right? Should they keep him around and hope for him to return to his previous production, or is he tradable? And the question is, what are they getting? I would argue at this point, this is exactly what I was saying about Rubio, if Bledsoe was moved without getting a productive player back just to get the eighth pick in the draft, you've done something wrong.
I'm never a fan of a team trading up their pick to get another team's pick. I don't think that's smart. But if you have an unproductive player that has some trade value and you trade that player for a pick, I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah, and it's, I mean,
I read a lot of the Massey Thaler stuff, so I apply the NFL drafts ideology basically to the all drafts are pretty much the same if you just want to look at it that way.
Oh, and sorry to cut in again. It looks like, Brian, according to the things in terms of Sacramento and Phoenix, they're saying Brandon Knight. So if Bledsoe and Knight are moved, that'll be interesting. To be fair, if Phoenix is getting rid of Brandon Knight, good on you. That was such a horrible signing. I can't believe you all did that. Maybe you're going to get your head on straight again.
Supposedly Sacramento is – oh, go ahead, Andrew.
Brandon Knight had a really good season in that Milwaukee season. I think injuries and stuff too, though.
Yeah. But,
okay. Let's. I'm going to be. I don't even want to be contrarian, but I do want to counter that. So Brandon Knight's good season, right, in Milwaukee. I think he was like a little above average, if I'm not mistaken. He was a 0.131 wins per 48. Yeah. Reminder: wins per 48 of one is average. Again, above average, but he's an above average point guard. That didn't, you know, and then not only that, he was expecting a big pay raise. I am never a fan of paying, you know, I don't think you need to pay for a point guard unless they're one of the top five point guards in the league. That's kind of my.
So it looks like it's being reported it's going to be the number 13 pick from the Suns and Bojan Bogdanović for the number 8th pick. So Bogdanović is, you know, not much of a contributor. So it doesn't seem like the worst trade in the world.
It's Maurice Chris who's getting traded to the Suns.
Chris is the player they're drafting.
No, but I'm saying I believe he's getting moved to the Suns is what all the reports are saying, if I'm not mistaken.
So my understanding is that the Phoenix Suns – oh, go ahead, Andrew.
So they got two young, shaky power forwards.
Yeah, so Chris is the player. He's coming out of Washington. He's going to get taken by Sacramento with the 8th pick. Now he's, you know, let's put him up on screen here. He was about 1,000th in the ratings, but I saw him play with the eye test, so I think it's, you know, maybe a little better than that. He was a good rebounder and shot blocker, but maybe
according
not.
According to Dave's numbers, I mean, this is remarkable. I mean, we're going to have to write this article tomorrow or, you know, Brian. You want some work, because I've already put out an article. We've done two podcasts, thanks to Andrew. I think I'm done with production for this week. But it is a bit remarkable that if we look at Dave's numbers, you know, in the top 10, we are, you know, in the top 10 picks, we've already seen three of Dave's bottom 15 picks get selected.
And he just got compared to Rashard Lewis. That's not good.
No, Rashard Lewis is an interesting one where we talk about, you know, he's the inverse of what you kind of like, Brian, where you keep saying you can play Draymond Green as a small forward. Rashard Lewis was a very productive small forward who Stan Van Gundy has admitted this. When he was on the Magic, basically there was an injury to, and I don't even remember the player, that's how long ago it was. There was an injury to their starting. Say again?
No, it was like 10 years ago or more.
Wow, gee, you're right. Jeez. Okay. Anyway, there was an injury. There was an injury to the starting power forward on the Magic, and so this was like a pre-small ball thing. He played Rashard Lewis at the starting power forward because he basically went, I'm out of players that can play power forward. Rashard can play up, and we can play a decent person below him. So that's what happened. And then his numbers just weren't as good because, you know, he was playing out of position. So I don't think that's a bad comparison to have. I certainly don't believe it. I mean, what we keep seeing with these draft picks, and I'm sorry, this is kind of a mean thing to say, is when you've got players close to average or below average in the NBA drafts, it is very, very, very optimistic of you to expect them to turn into super productive NBA players.
Yeah, and just to bring up the point you were talking about earlier, we've only had Ben Simmons is the only kind of top win producer that's been picked so far. All these other guys have been way down the list.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, only guy right now that I'm interested to see like where he goes is Joe Chi. He's this Chinese big man. And he looks amazing in his CBA numbers.
Is that the guy that can like dunk without jumping, or is that someone else? I was watching videos on some guy from that league.
I don't think so. I don't think he's that tall. But he's like 7'2", and he's like 20 years old. So nice. He's like young, and he's good, great shot blocker.
And by the way, sorry to get back to this. I'm like 95% certain that Chris is going to the Suns for something. So we'll figure out the full.
Yes.
So
he's wearing the Kings hat right now, but he's going for the 13th pick and Bogdan Bojanovic, according to Wojnarowski.
Your guy Masai is up.
Okay, so yeah. I mean the only I'm not gonna lie, Masai could pick the worst five players in the draft with five picks if he had them. The only test for Masai this offseason, in my eyes, is DeRozan. What he does with DeMar DeRozan. So none of the I mean we keep coming back. This has got to be the worst podcast ever for a draft show. Most of this doesn't matter for next season. I'm really sorry to say that. Yeah. Even Ben, okay. This sounds really stupid on my part. I was looking over the numbers this today, and I looked at the 76ers, and I had to remind myself that they only won 10 games last season. I forgot how bad they were. And to that point, I'm sorry, there is no world in which you can conceivably believe that Ben Simmons, an improvement to their youth, is even going to get them near 30 wins at this point. No. So. Even
they're trying
the best
to trade Okafor and Noel for veterans, but yeah, I mean they've got it's like Patrick's ladder of success, right? They're at the bottom. They dug themselves a hole below the ladder that they need to get out before they can even get to the first rung.
Well, and I mean even to that point, what I find amusing is Okafor, even for the stupid pundits, and I'm sorry, ESPN. I saw sites like ESPN and NBA.com have them their top five for Rookie of the Year, which is freaking ridiculous. Jokic got robbed. I said it. Actually, yeah. That's not true. That's not true. Carl Anthony Towns totally deserved it.
Maybe he was better, but Towns played so many minutes. I think you got to give it to Towns.
No, it was totally Towns' award.
I think Denver held him bad, though. So I think
right. I don't hate that, though. I mean, I think Moutier versus Jokic are two examples of
Jakob Poeltl to Toronto.
Oh, that's a Masai pick. He's one of the best players.
That's a great pick.
So what do we got?
Jakob Poeltl.
Yeah, the Utah center. He was a really dominant player in college. That's a Masai pick right there.
And how do you spell the last name?
Poeltl, I want to say. There's actually no R in it, even though you pronounce the R.
Poeltl.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, I'm going to tweet this out. You guys keep talking.
Yeah.
That was a great pick. And good shot blocker. And then he has the ability to stretch too a little bit, and I think in college he played center, but they're listing him as a power forward, so his numbers might have even been a little held back by that center position.
He was the best player that made a team with a deep tournament run and just dominated all year. So
and played last year, one of my favorite guys from last year's draft, DeLon Wright.
Yeah, that's right. No pun intended. Sorry, that's
killed
correct.
It in the D League. And he should have got a few more minutes. But we'll see what Masai does with DeRozan. From what I've heard, I think he kind of likes DeRozan, and it might be that he might bring him back.
Oh no, he should be going for trying to get their other big man back. Why from getting his name? The old Charlotte guy.
I will say this does seem like this follows under Yamba. The exact type of pick that I love,
yeah.
the Jakob, because it's a young player. He's the let's see, in terms of freshmen or sophomores, he's one of the, you know, Sabonis is one of the only people above him. He's super tall. He's 7 feet tall. You know, he's big. He's already got some weight in him. So, yeah, this is a fantastic pick. And I'm glad.
And what was his birth year? His birth year?
That's a good question. We can scroll over here. We have it on the spreadsheet.
Because I tend to look at the how old they are a little bit more than other people.
Oh, maybe we don't have age. Sorry. We'll find it.
1995, he's 20 years old.
Okay, so
he's
like
a sophomore.
But he's like a junior age. He's a junior age sophomore.
He'll be 21 at the start of the NBA season.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you might get, with that age, you can look at that ROI and on that rookie contract, it'll probably be a better value than a guy who's 19, like a Brandon Ingram. I think Brandon Ingram might be productive on the second contract instead of on that first contract.
Oh, well, no, Jalen Rose is comparing him to Chris Kaman. That's a bad sign for him, but I think he's going to be better.
Chris Kaman had a few good years, but I don't think that's good.
Well, famously, Dre, maybe you want to explain this. Wages of Wind got into an argument with Mark Cuban about Chris Kaman.
We got nothing, you know, we got nothing out of this where basically Mark Cuban and the Mavericks picked up Chris Kaman, and I basically argued it was a horrible pick. And Mark Cuban actually ended up in the Wages of Wind's comment section, was kind of saying our system, our whatever. And I basically made the argument that we've been making on the show, you know, there's no reason not to start with productive players, that there is absolutely no reason not to do that. And I basically said Chris Kaman was just not productive. So instead of investing, I think it was like $8 million a year. It was only for a season, but it was still $8 million. Instead of investing $8 million on an unproductive player you hope you could turn productive, why not invest $8 million in a productive player?
And make him even better.
Make him even more productive-y. So, yeah, to that point, that's a horrible comparison. But to yours, I mean, this guy, if you've got a checklist, and I think Kevin Broome's article would be the same thing, this is a... Not super young. That's the interesting thing. You know, 'cause to your point, he is basically a junior. But, you know, you've got a relatively tall, relatively productive, not super old, right? He's not a senior, so that's fine. And what's interesting, you just made the Ingram might be good on a second contract. Another player that was kind of like that for us that we actually bashed. This is embarrassing for me. Washington Wizards guard.
John Wall.
John Wall is exactly like that. We didn't think he was a great draft pick. We didn't think he was great on his rookie contract, and he actually is worth the money on a second rookie contract, at least for a season before injury. So I think it's funny that teams, you know, it's interesting. This was a Moneyball story where teams would draft high school players. What? And what they actually discovered, you know, at least at the time, because this is a fluid market, right? This is an economy. The market as to what's valuable changes as people learn. And this happens much more. Like the 76ers, the Warriors with their light years ahead, our strategy, I think that's crap. I think get the ball through the hoop is not a hard strategy to game. The draft strategy can change a little. I'm sorry, go ahead, Andrew.
But taking out the outcome of how that second deal ended up panning out, that first deal was bad. And I think they just looked up that he turned into a good player that second.
Exactly.
Another example of that would be if they re-sign Bradley Beal. If Bradley Beal ends up turning into a star player, it's still, to me, I think you just got lucky.
Yeah, we name a lot of things on the show, and you know the example I would definitely call there is I would call that the Zach Randolph principle. Zach Randolph's a player that got traded, picked up by the Memphis Grizzlies after they gave up on Pau Gasol stupidly, and he ended up being great. He was a fantastic player. He's a big part of why, you know, they upset the Spurs and had those playoff runs. And the reality was that's outcome based. That was luck. You know, we shouldn't reward that pick. That decision was stupid in every meaningful manner except for, you know, what actually ended up happening. And if you turn too much outcome based without actually analyzing what you thought at the time, you're basically just hoping for luck.
You ready for some breaking news, guys?
What do we got?
We've got it. We've got Milwaukee with the number 10 pick are going to take Thon Maker, who is an international player out of the Sudan, who is 19 years old, but according to the Washington Post, scouts aren't sure how old he is, so he's probably a guy with no data. And then we have another pick, though. Orlando will select Domantas Sabonis with the 11th pick, a guy who did produce in college. So
fascinating. Quick question to you as the group. Does it appear that the 9th through 11th picks have been better than the 1 through 3 picks?
I mean, they're probably about the same, right? They're probably not much worse. And so I guess kind of one of the overall lessons from us today is that late first-round picks are underrated, but high first-round picks are overrated, basically.
But the real answer I give you there is just because it's a trick. You know, they have completely screwed rookies when it comes to the value that they can get paid. There is not a single draft pick that gets paid with their...
Ben Simmons probably could get like $12-15 million a year if it's the open market.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that my favorite example of this is Kevin Durant versus Oden. Are you honestly telling me that Kevin Durant was worth... I think it ended up being worth about $2 million over their first four seasons. Are you honestly telling me that any team could look you in the eye and say that Kevin Durant was worth $2 million less than Greg Oden?
And given how much they love young players, Simmons probably could get the max.
I by the way, I am excited about this 7'3" wingspan, 9'3". Somewhere it's, you know, it's arguable. I see two measurements for him: one at the All Canadian game, one at the draft combine.
Yeah.
But they're saying he has between a 9'3" to 9'6".
But he's a
standing reach.
He's a mystery box.
He is.
So,
every now and then those mystery box pan out like LeBron. To me, I wouldn't have taken LeBron. I know
people. Oh, really? Are you going here?
I wouldn't have taken LeBron.
I like this argument.
I wouldn't have taken, or Dwight Howard. I wouldn't have taken those guys number one.
Because their high school data isn't relevant, basically.
Yeah, I mean, and it's just, I don't know. That's two levels you have to jump. Well, three levels if you're counting European basketball.
What's fascinating to me about that point, Andrew, and I disagree wholeheartedly. I can't believe that. But
can you say, are you a victim to outcome bias on that?
Well, so that's what's interesting to me is that, you know, when you look at how NBA teams did, if you look at high school players, this is always fascinating to me, you know, when they implemented the one and done rule, when Adam Silver is arguing players need to go to college for 2 years, yada, 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 right? When you look at all these rules, what's fascinating to me is if you look at the historical outcome of high school players picked in the NBA draft, they did great. NBA teams seem to be better at picking high school players than college. Now, to be fair, if you're a high school player that makes it to the draft, you have to be damn good. So that was always kind of remarkable to me, is that these players that were high school that could convince them had to be really, really good. And what's funny is as soon as you hit college, you can be decent. That's the Ingram problem, right? You can be Brandon Ingram, and, you know, people are willing to, you know, take a chance on you even though your college numbers aren't great. But if he's in high school, he needs to be great.
I just want to jump in with one thing about Thon Maker before you reply, Andrew, is that they were just showing a graphic on ESPN of, like, the course he's taken with his life. He escaped from the Sudan Civil War at age 6. He went to Australia after that. Then he went to the U.S. at age 14. Then he went to Canada at age 17. So, man, good on him for getting drafted and getting through all that. So.
I think he might start a trend with that with high school players, is that they go to Canada for like prep school. He graduated four years and then he did another year at a prep school in Canada, and then another option is doing the Dante Exum, where basically he like worked out like how young athletes would do for like the Olympics.
Another Australian.
Yep.
The Canada thing is definitely fascinating. I'd love to see there be a problem with Canada complaining about NBA players invading Canada.
But I think GMs were drafting those high school players, but they were just basically going off of the rankings though. And how coveted those guys would be. So it's basically, it's the same thing now. They just have to do another year. Have to do a year of college.
Well, anyway, all I can say is I am excited. I am very excited about Thon Maker. You know what? He probably is a mystery box. He probably won't pan out. But most draft picks don't. You know, that's go big or go home. And, you know, they went for a, you know, they say go big or go home. They went for a 7'1" player. So there you go.
And I want to respond to when you said you're surprised that the later picks are better picks than the early picks. It's just like the best pick. I mean, the best player available is not going to, most likely, is not going to be the number one. So it's not really that surprising.
You know what I think it is the freshmen and sophomores tend to go earlier because they have more of that high school hype you were talking about. But now we're getting down into the seniors and juniors who have that track record of producing wins in college. And those are the guys we think are easier to project.
And they say that's a detriment. For whatever reason, a more realized player is a more of a detriment than a player that possibly is closer to an unknown, which I think this is backwards, like it's logic, backwards logic.
I'll be right back, guys, but keep on going.
Oh, sorry, we both ditched you there, Andrew, because if you might have heard some rustling, I got up to plug in my computer because the battery's getting low.
Yeah, I was about to do the same thing.
We almost left dead air. You know what I'm going to do? Because let's see, do we have any, has anybody else come through? Interesting. My Firefox is freezing up, so that's fun.
I was gonna say. Ask you what happened to Patrick.
Patrick, he's just been busy with work. You know, he got married this last year. I mean, it's one of those funny things where it's not surprising. One thing you quickly learn, because you know I've been doing this for years now, is just how quickly life gets in the way and how it's actually rare to have as much time as some of us have had to just devote so much work and effort to, you know, NBA stuff. So way it goes, I'm sure, you know, he's missed being on the podcast.
But yeah, I've been reading a lot of draft coverage the last couple of days, and I just realized like how like people love the draft and how sad that kind of is, that people are so wrapped up into this this novelty of hope.
To be fair, you know, we are definitely in a glass house throwing stones here as we're doing a live NBA draft where we've just produced a bunch of numbers and we tweet about it all the time. Yeah. So I do want to make sure that we're at least somewhat self-aware there.
I think even if I wasn't doing, like, if I wasn't on tonight, I would probably not be watching this. I would probably be watching FIBA basketball or some soccer.
Oh, I don't understand. I'm gonna put myself
party on soccer. I'm getting into it slowly.
I was gonna say I may be throwing myself under the bus here to all of the Box Score Geeks fans just based on numbers and stuff, but you know, some of the comments, I just do not get soccer, and so many people seem to like soccer, and I don't.
All of those sports like that, soccer, football, hockey, they're basically like you're watching a dice roll. So it's so funny that
I grew up playing it, so I love it still. But I mean, I think that's what it is people in Europe and South America grew up playing it, and those of us in America who did like it too. But yeah, if you didn't grow up playing it, yeah, it's just, it's a little bit tough.
If you're like a fan of players getting like more power, it's just better. They can choose where they want to work, get as much money as they want.
Yeah, I mean, okay. I would say going for international sports is a little easier. Even things like the Olympics are rough, right? The Olympics are super tough to root for. So,
yeah. Even though I do watch Olympic basketball.
All right, so yeah, I mean,
guys, I have an announcement here. Are we ready to bring Patrick Minton onto the broadcast?
Oh, Patrick wants to come on. Yeah. Heck yeah, let's do this.
All right, let's bring him in. It's gonna blow up the video, but that's okay.
Let me get my charger. I'm charging this up.
All right, he's coming out. We've got him, the original NBA geek, Patrick Minton. How's it going?
I'm sorry to blow up the video.
No, actually, you're in Dre's spot now, and Andrew's in his own spot, and Dre doesn't have video anyway, so it worked out.
Hey, Patrick.
Hey, Andrew.
Do you have any thoughts so far, Patrick? Or I don't know, if you might probably just driven home, so you may have all be adjusting this.
No,
so
I'm actually at work. I don't know if you can see behind me, but I have a soundproof room.
Sorry. Oh, nice. I got some of that on my wall too, Patrick. That's awesome.
It's I don't think anyone can hear me here at the office, so if I scream really loud when that Butler trade finally happens.
I don't think Jimmy Butler, after that stupid Derrick Rose trade, I don't think the Butler trade's happening. I'm actually proud of the Bulls. They recouped. They're gonna be able to replace most of Noah's production with Robin Lopez. So, you know, if they, you know, they hold the course, they'll be fine next season.
I agree with you, but it seems like they want to make that trade happen.
And I mean, I don't agree.
I don't have any faith in the Bulls front office.
Well, I don't have faith in the Timberwolves front office either, but
I wish I could say I hate to do this, Patrick, but you know what? I don't care about burning a couple bridges, and I doubt they watch. When you and I were at Sloan, a guy at like one of the Sloan parties like approached us and was like asking us some questions, and he's like, you know, I'm just not, you know, he's like, I don't really get a lot of Dave Barry's work, and I'm not a big fan, and he's like, and I'd love to talk to you guys more though. And it was a guy that worked with the Bulls. It was like a Bulls analytics guy. We had a couple people.
It was
like
the
that.
Raptors, actually.
No, we had both, dude. We had the Raptors and the Bulls. Yeah, the Raptors guy was interesting too.
The Raptors guy was supposedly the director of analytics for them.
Wow.
And he was, you know, he said a lot about how, you know, we don't like Dave Barry, and we think he's, and basically when we tried to follow up and like say, you know, well, what specifically about his methodologies don't you like? And it was all like, you could tell he was just pulling shit out of his ass, because he essentially, it all boiled down to basically, well, the players that his model likes, I don't think they're good, therefore his methodology must suck. And I'm thinking, that's not really a very scientific approach to the problem, but whatever.
Is he still there at the Raptors, or is this a previous regime?
No, I don't even remember the guy's name.
Oh, so. Okay.
And like Dre says, I could give a rat's ass about whether or not people who work for analytics departments at NBA teams me like either. It or not, because you know, A, the chance that I'd ever get the opportunity to work for an NBA team is very slim, and B, the chance that any NBA team would ever offer me even remotely the amount of money to make it worth my while to work for them is also, I mean, I'm sure an NBA team would love to have my expertise for like $75,000 a year or some bullshit number, but...
Patrick, and this is one reason I like working with you, interestingly, so hopefully it doesn't come off too mean, it's like, I would expect that like at meeting number three, you would just go on a tirade-laden curse rant at them about some stupid
stuff. Is that why you have a soundproof room at work, Patrick?
I don't know if it would last all the way to number three. It might be number two. Right? It would depend on whether or not anyone took anything I said in meeting number one seriously, and then meeting number two might be like that if no one did.
Let's actually hop into the draft. I'm curious about this. Have you seen
breaking news, Dre?
Oh, what do we got? So apparently the rule is we're always going to be one pick behind what Waj or somebody is reporting. So yeah. The 11th pick, Sabonis, just went, according to us. But
okay, we're following the TV, not Waj.
We're doing both. We're doing both. We're hopping back.
Well, we shouldn't follow the TV. We should follow Waj, because that makes no sense. Waj is three picks ahead.
Here's what we're doing. I'm showing Waj Jarowski's Twitter as it breaks, and then we're flipping to the TV a little bit later after we've been talking about it. So we got a little delayed reaction. But here's what he's reporting right now, guys. Oklahoma City has traded Serge Ibaka to the Orlando Magic. And then 2 minutes after that, he's reporting Orlando will send Victor Oladipo, Ersan Ilyasova, and the rights to Sabonis to the Thunder. So I don't know if that's an update to the trade or a new trade that they traded two different things. But anyway, no matter what happens, it sounds like the Thunder are shaking things up, and maybe Orlando will benefit.
Can you say those three players again? It's Ibaka, Ilyasova, and...
So there's the first trade is Ibaka for who knows what. The second trade is Oladipo, Ilyasova, and the rights to Sabonis. Okay, so that's it. That's it. Never mind. Two tweets for the same thing. That's what it means.
Sorry, so Ibaka for what now?
Ilyasova, and the rights to Sabonis.
I love this.
I mean, I like the trade for Orlando. I don't like it for
Ilyasova. Okay,
so Ilyasova seems all right, but he seems to be basically a lot of overlap with Kanter, a lot of the defensive problems that Kanter has, right? And
he's not young anymore either.
He's not young anymore. And Ibaka is a dominant big man. I mean,
but he hasn't been. He was I mean, we can hope he's back. He looked decent in the playoffs. He was horrendous last season.
Yeah, Andrew, you're not a fan of him after his injuries, right?
But that's the thing. Like, players come back from injuries, and it's very rare for a player to just jump in and be his old self. It's super common. You look back in time, especially for big men, guys like Tyson Chandler and other people. They come back from a bad injury, and they are not anywhere near themselves for a while. But then once they're back to themselves, then. You know, players usually remember how to play, right? I mean, it's fairly uncommon for a guy with a really long history of being very good to suddenly just not be good anymore. Right? I mean, that can sometimes happen when guys that were very good because they didn't shoot very much suddenly start shooting a lot, like which seemed to have happened with Andre Drummond, for instance. But for the most part, players that were really, really good stay really, really good, and then if they have an off year, it's usually a bad idea to abandon it.
Yeah, but I mean, what I will say is, I actually don't give a damn about Ilyasova. I don't. He wasn't productive.
He wasn't that productive, Dre.
He wasn't that productive last season.
Assuming he plays point guard, shooting guard, Oladipo is obviously a huge upgrade over Deion Waiters. There's no question.
Yeah. So then Sabonis seems like a good one. So I mean, from that perspective, if they're keeping Kevin Durant, sorry, there are too many good Kevins. Keeping Kevin Durant, that means they've got, you know, Westbrook, Oladipo, how am I dropping it? Kevin Durant, I dropped his name twice. Steve Adams, Kanter, if they're smart enough to play that, and then some decent players off the bench. So I'm a fan. Oh, no. Oh, my. Patrick, you ready? Are you ready for Christmas?
What happened?
All right. Brian, why don't you break the news to him?
Oh, I haven't seen it yet. It looks like Jimmy Butler went through those. Is that what you're hinting?
It's up to date. What's happening?
Whoa.
Jimmy Butler goes to the... Brian, you're dropping the ball here.
I don't have it. Tell me.
Jimmy Butler goes to the Timberwolves for Chris Dunn, Zach LaVine, and a second-round pick. Are you kidding me?
Highway robbery, Patrick. Highway robbery.
No way.
Wow.
That is highway robbery.
And if they keep Rubio, man, that's going to be a good team.
Oh, my God.
Even if they don't, the fact that they didn't have to give up Rubio to get that, even if they decide to trade Rubio for something else, that is just highway robbery. There's no way that could be true. That can't possibly be true.
Oh, my God. That
can't possibly be true, can it?
We'll I don't know.
I don't see the Wolves trade. Where are you getting this? I don't see it.
I really hope this isn't fake. If this is fake,
it's fake. Look at the handler, man. Look at the at sign.
Oh my God. Oh my God. This is like getting fucking Rickrolled. I apologize. That actually got a curse bomb
out
of me.
The check mark, man.
Rookie mistake on draft. Dre got fake washed on draft day. Oh my God. Amateur mistake.
If it makes you feel any better, he was retweeted by Brent Berry. Brent Berry fell for the wash.
Brent Berry's fallen for this in the past, though.
God, I may jump off the show now, Patrick. Jeez.
No. That's okay. It may still happen.
Kerryon Prince at goes NFL through the best draft. Ofs.
Nobody blats an eye at the fact that at NFL best ofs tweeted out a tweet about a basketball trade.
Yeah, it's a good thing Andrew's not here to see this for his Hawks. Torian Prince is not rated very highly in wins produced, but. We'll see. And he's also a senior, too, so he's probably older.
I thought he went to the Jazz, though, or did he get traded?
Oh, maybe. They're saying Atlanta, but I don't know.
Oh, is it a trade?
No, we'll see.
I mean, it does seem like the discussions between the two are heating up, but that's a Mark Stein tweet. I'm never really quite sure how I feel about that.
We'll see. There's a lot of good guys left at the top of the spreadsheet, though, still.
Well, and that happens every year, right?
Yeah.
The thing we need to reemphasize is it's not like we think all those guys at the top of those spreadsheets are going to be amazing. It's more like, okay, if you're trying to hit singles and doubles and home runs, you know, you got to be trying to like pick guys that, I mean, that's a terrible metaphor. Let me start over. So you're trying to place a lot of bets and hopefully one of your bets works
out.
There we go. And I mean, if you're putting all your eggs in a basket where, you know, it's got a low probability of working out, then your chances aren't very good. You want to spread them around, and you want to say a guy who has a 40% chance of being good is better than a guy who has a 30% chance of being good. And that's really what we're talking about when we talk about the top of the draft board versus the bottom. Like, the guys at the top of the draft board have like a 40% chance of being good, and the guys at the bottom have like a 30% chance of being good. And what we're saying is that NBA teams right now, using their eye tests and their scouting, they're just throwing darts at a board, and we can do slightly better by like putting a little stabilizer on their arm before they throw the dart. I mean, it's not like we're making it's not like we're saying, okay, you know, if somebody drafts Thomas Walkup, he'll be an instant superstar. That's not like the thing, right?
But well, Dre likes his name, though, I have to say.
I'd totally put him in the same category as like a Jay Crowder, where, you know, he might come into the league and be like, for a few years, and then suddenly be a very productive, very valuable guy. And you don't have to become that valuable in order for you to be a win most guys that get drafted after 3 or 4 years, they're out, right? Most guys that get drafted after the rookie contract, they just kind of fiddle out. They become the Jimmy Federers, right? That's most guys. So to have a guy who becomes a solid rotation player is actually a super win from the draft.
Yeah, I think he could probably be had undrafted. So that's even better value.
So for any team, the best value is to draft him in the second round and lock him in for 4 years. Right? Because if he becomes a free agent, you might get him for 2 years. And then I'm pretty sure also that you have problems with bird rights and things like that if he's undrafted, right? Because player can basically do the KJ.
I was going to say Jeremy Lin.
Or KJ McDaniels, right? Who was also undrafted, I think. And then he signed a 1 year contract. And then he was a free agent after that. And from a team's perspective, that's the worst case scenario, because if you really think Thomas Walkup is a good long shot, then you want him for 4 years, or you want that option to have him for 4 years and lock him in.
It was like when you were talking with Arturo about Clint Capella, the risk that you take, that's another team is going to take him.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's so easy to get a second round pick, and that's what's funny is that you can basically, I think the Nuggets actually did this for money at one point. They got a late first round that turned into Ty Lawson. They basically, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, went up to the Wolves, who drafted every point guard except the good point guards in that draft, an impressive accomplishment I don't think has been matched since. They went up to the Wolves and said, here is some money for a draft pick. Can we have Ty Lawson? And they said, okay. And, you know, you can do that. So if you really like a player, like to your point, Patrick, yeah, spend the money, get a second round pick, spend the second round pick on the player you want, and then you have the restricted free agency rights.
Yeah, Patrick's poker analogy is the best one I think I've heard. So that's a good, that's a great analogy, the poker analogy.
Yeah, it's great. Like if you're trying to bet on hitting a flush, right? And you're not gonna very often, but you would rather, you know, it depends on what the payout odds are, right? And so if you can, but you know, if you hit that flush, you're gonna be like, woohoo!
Right? They're all inside straight draws, right?
Well, that's the thing, though, is like, that's what I'm saying, is like, you know, the bottom of the draft, those are like trying to hit on an inside straight, and the top of the draft, you're trying to hit on a flush.
Yeah.
But when you're trying to, even when you're trying to hit on a flush, even when you got nine cards coming, you're still only going to hit it like a third of the time. So you're talking about hitting it a third of the time versus 20% of the time.
Now, let me ask you guys this. Are the late first round picks even better than the second? Because don't they get an extra year from those late first round picks?
Yeah.
They do, but they also
they have to pay them more, though.
Well, no, the second round
option flexibility is also lower, right? Because
with the
second round picks, you can do so. All first round picks follow the structure where you have to give them a team option in, I think, years 3, 4, and 5, right? Whereas with the second round pick, you can make all kinds of things. You can say, okay, we get a team option for years 2 through 4. After the first year or things like that, you can.
Well,
do
no, the second round pick, they get 2 years. They get 2 years guaranteed with both first and second. With the first round picks, they basically get a team option in years 3 and year 4, and then restricted free agency right in year 5. With a first round pick, the problem they run into is they basically get that restricted free agency after year 2, and that's where you get a Jeremy Lin, where their contract explodes, and another team can be savvy and offer them a lot of money. You know, still not a ton. You know, I think Jeremy Lin made $8 million a season, but still enough to make things, and then also make, like you were saying, they're allowed to structure it how they want to, you know, muck with your cap.
Phoenix takes Georgios Papagiannis.
Well, I like the name.
If he's got Giannis in his name, he's got to be good, right?
He's young, big and young, and he played for Panathinaikos. Is that how you say it? Panathinaikos?
Oh yeah, but that's a really good league, right? That's one of the best leagues in Europe. Yeah. Maybe Patrick, you know that.
I will note that the last four picks, you know, have a Taurean Prince notwithstanding, but picks 9, 10, 11, and 13 are all, you know, 7-footers. That's an interesting, you know, I have no complaints with that.
I think Taurean Prince is one of those guys who benefits from scouts' love for 3-and-D guys, which I think is stupid because you can get him lower. And yeah. You can get 3-and-D guys for cheap.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like somebody in my feed when I was saying that the Timberwolves should do pretty much everything that doesn't involve Karl Anthony Towns and Ricky Rubio to get Butler, and some guy was complaining, yeah, but then what do? They won't have any shooting. What will they do? And I'm like, well, you go out in the free agency market, you pay $6 million a year, and you can get a guy who shoots 40% from three. It's not really that hard. And people are complaining that, oh, but Wiggins can't shoot. And then the answer to that is, well, then Wiggins probably should spend some time on the bench, right? I mean, I think that the years where Wiggins just gets to play 37 minutes a game, no matter how he performs, are now over because I don't think Thibodeau is going to do that, right? I think Thibodeau is going to basically make guys who win play. But, I mean, I'm guessing if he were able to get a guy like Butler, he would also be entrusting a lot of the ball handling duties to Butler, and that would be that would have the virtue of taking a ball out of Andrew Wiggins' hands. And then either Wiggins learns to shoot from the opportunities he gets, being able to spot up off the ball with guys like Butler and Rubio, or he sits down.
Okay, question for you, Patrick. If you're the front office for Minnesota, you've seen a huge amount of minutes from Wiggins these first 2 years. There was a team option. They probably already extended it. So, but would you have extended that team offer? The team option?
I'm going to be cynical here and say I would extend it with the eye towards trading him.
Yeah, I agree.
Overvalued. I think his perceived value is just sky high.
So the Bulls are on the clock now. Maybe this is a time to trade Butler. I don't know. We'll see.
I think we got we could name another conundrum. The Andrew Wiggins conundrum is where you give a young player way too many minutes his first 2 years, and they don't pan out, but you still stick with it.
That's like the Wolves, as we've mentioned. That's the Wolves' problem, right? That should just be named after the Timberwolves. The Timberwolves strategy.
Well, let me play devil's advocate here and say that they're leagues full of guys who stunk their first couple of years but then turned around and became productive. I think Andrew Wiggins is I'm not high on Andrew Wiggins at all, but I do think that it is too early for us to be sure that he'll, you know, never become a very good productive player. I'll remind everybody that Kevin Durant basically stunk his first couple of years as well. But I mean, in all honesty, in the Timberwolves position that they were in, it didn't really do them any harm to have Andrew Wiggins playing all those minutes, because it's not like the difference between winning 25 games and winning 35 games really makes a substantial impact for them. Or I guess in Wiggins' rookie year, it's the difference between winning 16 games and winning 25 games. I think the key problem is not falling in love with them because you've got all these sunk costs. But that's,
I was going to say, yeah.
But that's the advantage of Thibodeau, is he has no sunk cost because it wasn't him. He wasn't the guy that drafted him and gave him all those minutes. So for him, he has no emotional investment in Andrew Wiggins. I think that he's probably going to be fairly objective about Andrew Wiggins. I guess we'll Timberwolves fans can hope. We'll have to wait and see.
So by the way, I've got to read one of the stupidest draft tweets I've read. Not that it's super bad, but according to Wojnarowski on the Yahoo Draft Show, so not that, Tibbs called Towns, Karl Anthony Towns, to get his opinion on a Jimmy Butler deal. Do you really need to call Karl Anthony Towns and to ask if you'd like Jimmy Butler on the squad? Is that really something? Like, do you think what is Karl Anthony Towns going to say there? Nah, it kind of sucks. What? Sorry. Oh, and by the way, Georgios, I'm not even going to try his last name because I'm just going to mess it up.
Papa Giannis.
He's basically Papa John's.
Yeah.
Oh, how long is it going to take before he has a marketing deal with Papa John's Pizza?
Now, interestingly, he's going to Sacramento, and Sacramento has the pizza guys that have traditionally targeted Kings players, so maybe there's that. They could, you know, actually, that's kind of funny, Patrick. I go, you can call the right Papa. There you go. I like it. Get on it. He actually goes to the Kings. He was selected with the Suns pick, but that's a swap. Basically, the Kings and the Suns both used a pick on I don't know what the numbers are. He's another magic box, right? Georgios is an 18-year-old 7-footer from overseas with limited minutes. So he's a mystery box. We'll see what comes of that. But to be said, what somebody noted is the Kings now have DeMarcus Cousins.
I was going to say,
they have a lot of bigs. Willie Cauley-Stein, Kostas Koufos, and this. I mean, I don't actually hate stockpiling good bigs, but the thing is, of course, they're going to pick DeMarcus Cousins and trade the two most productive. So that's what's going to happen.
Reminds me of that Utah problem. In 2011-12, around when Millsap and Derek Favors, they had all these bigs, and it's just, there's only so many Favors. Big minutes.
I've got breaking news, by the way, guys. We've got 10 people in Twitch chat right now, and apparently we had 13 a little bit earlier. It's a world record for our chat. So thanks, everyone, for joining in and getting trolled by our announcements and everything. I love it.
Yeah, oh, I like
it. But I think I'm one of those 10 people.
That's fine, too. And the other thing that's going to happen, too, by the way, I hate to do this to you. Patrick and I are both actually in soundproofish rooms. I'm in my office in Appleton. It is hot as heck up here. The AC doesn't hit this room very well. We said we weren't going to go too long. Obviously, I know you came in late, Patrick, but we've almost been going now. I say, let's get out of the first round, and then I'll probably be ready to go. Because I may die of heat exhaustion.
That sounds like another hour, Dre.
No. Draft lottery, sorry. And that just happens.
Denzel Valentine for Chicago.
Interesting.
Oh, great pick.
Now maybe it's a good no. I actually like it because
I know where you're going.
this is another Draymond Green, by the way, a senior from Michigan State who we love. He's at the top of our list, right? Yeah. I think according to the numbers that Dave sent over, where is he? Like top five, top 10?
Yeah, so he's number two. In the smaller list, but in the whole list, he's still really high up there. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but he's a shooting guard.
The whole Draymond Green prototype now. European basketball's been doing this.
Yeah.
European basketball's been doing this.
Yeah.
They've had small ball fours forever now. It's just
NBA. Out of necessity, right? Because they don't. I mean, most of the guys that were bigger were going to the NBA.
But he's 6'6", and he went to Michigan State. I mean, it's hard to resist that comparison, I think, for most people.
Absolutely.
But I mean more of the line of the guys who were productive in college. They got passed up because they were short. Because I look at if you look at a lot of old Turo stuff from Ways to Wins, a lot of those guys are actually productive now overseas.
Yeah,
it's just funny that NBA teams don't try to get those guys cheap free agents.
So one of his favorite guys of all time, or maybe it was Ari Caroline, is John Bryant out of Santa Clara, a big guy who went to Europe. I wonder how he's doing, because apparently he had crazy numbers. I don't know.
Yeah, he's a pretty good player over in German league.
Interesting. That's a good league too, actually. Well, Patrick, you should know.
That was your article, Patrick, where Patrick said why would you target Bryant? Why would you target Kobe Bryant when you could target John Bryant? I think is what you said back in the day. Sadly, he's still overseas.
Yeah, and by now I think he's too old for the NBA.
Yeah, he's probably over 30 now.
No, I think he's like 28 or 29.
Okay.
I mean, that's at the point where it's just, you know, by the time he's adjusted to the NBA, you know, it's not. I mean, it doesn't have a huge upside for most teams, I guess, right?
Yeah.
I think the real guys who kind of are going missing now are, you know, like Thomas Walkup or the guys who play for small schools who, I mean, and it is a red flag when you play for a small school because of the level of competition. But at the same time, if you are completely and utterly dominating that competition, then it seems like you should be given a chance to at least be compared to better competition, to at least see if you can cut it against the better competition, right?
I agree.
Oh, he looks so happy to be drafted, but, Denzel Valentine. Oh, go ahead, Andrew.
So, I mean, the tea leaves here are, like, is this the kind of pick where they're like, okay, we got our guy. Can we now get rid of – are we okay? Is it a backup for Jimmy Butler? Is Jimmy Butler now more available because they got this pick?
Which is silly.
Which I agree, but it benefits Patrick.
the interesting thing, I don't know. Let me take a look at his numbers real quick.
And we also have free agency coming up too, so we don't have the full how they're going to recover from that.
Well, here's the thing: Denzel Valentine in college gets 7.8 assists and 2.7 turnovers per game. And Jimmy Butler is actually a fairly good assister. So, I mean, this is, you know, we talk all the time about small ball and hybrids and whatever. If you've got two big passable, you know, they can both pass, both, you know, I'm assuming Denzel has to be good at defense. I mean, if he's not good at defense with his body type, I don't know what he's doing with his body type. So, why not put them both in the backcourt?
Play him at small forward at 6'6". He could do it.
I agree, but
I was going to say play him at small forward.
I think Patrick's still hoping.
I stole your thunder, Andrew.
Yeah.
It's
just like Draymond Green. I like Draymond Green more at the 3 than at the 4.
Well, you know, they'll play Kevin Durant at 3 next year, so he can keep playing 4.
Why wouldn't they play Kevin Durant at the 4?
Oh, they could. I mean, it's small ball, so anything goes. Yeah. It's positionless basketball, Patrick.
It's small ball when your power forward is 7 feet tall, right?
Oh boy!
All right, so I'm getting, you know, we got through the draft lottery. Not surprising, the second half of the draft lottery we liked better than the first half. Not a shocking surprise. Anything to end out on before we head out?
Yeah, ROI_S is telling in the chats that the Denver Nuggets will pick Juan Hernan Gomez.
Ooh.
Yeah, I don't know if I pronounced that right, but it looks like it.
Arturo loves that guy.
Oh, does he? Oh, yeah, that's right. He was tweeting about him earlier. So maybe the Nuggets got one good guy out of their two picks.
They just need a point guard. They just need a point guard.
Oh, yeah, no more Ty Lawson.
Well, no, Moutier is going to turn it around this season. Moutier is going to turn into what we need. He's going to do a Kevin Durant. He's going to be a star next season. It's all going to come together.
They just have to hold on to Fareed, right? It sounds like it's bad times for those trades.
Well, it depends on what they get. You know, with any trade.
Oh. Sorry.
The Clippers just traded Brandon Wright and the 17th pick for J.J. Redick and a future pick.
Really? Interesting.
Well, that's... Yeah. Wait, I thought Redick was on... Who is Redick on? I thought Redick was...
They traded Redick. I think that's what...
Yeah, the Clippers traded Redick. for Brandon.
Oh, they traded Reddick. Oh, so this is fantastic. Another year for Brandon Wright to play well in limited minutes and us to say if this team finally plays him 20 minutes a game, they could be good and then he won't.
Oh, you think Blake Griffin's going to be healthy, Patrick?
This is the third time, I think. I'm not sure, but I think this is the third time Brandon Wright has been traded for a number for a first-round pick, and they're still not going to give him the minutes he deserves.
Yeah,
oh, I've got a tweet. You guys keep talking. I got a tweet.
To be fair, on the Clippers, he's behind Griffin and Jordan. So, I mean, why are they drafting for this guy? That doesn't make any sense to me. Right. I mean,
this just paves the way for Austin Rivers to get in the starting lineup, which is what we've wanted all along.
It's probably Griffin insurance.
Yeah, maybe it's Griffin insurance, but at the same time, like, now their backcourt is even weaker.
Austin Rivers needs that starting spot. You guys know that. Come on.
They have a better chance of selling the free agents than the Lakers. So.
Yeah, that's true.
All the Clippers have ever needed to do is get a two-guard and a three-guard who can both shoot 40% beyond the three and play defense, and they don't need any other skills. If they just had that, they would be like a ridiculously strong team. And Redick kind of fits that bill, but... I mean, instead they're trotting out guys like Austin Rivers and Caron Butler and Lance Stevenson and I can't even, like, who else have they had there?
Jamal Crawford.
But he's ostensibly he's backing up Chris Paul, right? Although often enough he gets too many minutes.
Yeah, I think Austin Rivers is probably going to start now, which is going to be so funny because he loves his son so much.
It's so awful.
Hey, that's what you need to do with high positions of power, right? Nepotism.
Yep. Nepotism.
Sure, why not, you know?
I mean, I'd probably do the same thing. Because he's the GM, right? He's not going to fire
himself.
Well,
I'll probably do it in a matter of... Let's give my son something that doesn't matter. Let's give him a position of power that doesn't matter.
Nice. Well, so, I don't know, Dre, did you take off already or are you still here?
No, I'm still here.
Was that also a fake account? That might have also been a fake account.
Which one?
The
Brandon Wright trade may have been but that's a random fucking trade to throw out there if you're
above the gods in chat is saying it's not a real trade.
Rumor about Brandon Wright.
I'm gonna call that my sign, right, to get pulled. If I'm a pitcher, you get fooled for one fake thing. It's excusable. You get fooled by two, you know, that's when it's time to go.
Is that like a balk in baseball kind of, Dre?
I guess so. I say it's more like giving up a home run. So
No.
So that's what I got there. Anything you all want to end up on? Thanks for showing up, Patrick. Thanks for being on, Andrew. I'm just going to say my last comment again, 90% of these players aren't going to matter at all in 4 years. We're going to forget them all. Nothing matters. Everything is meaningless. That's my nihilistic approach to the draft. I'm out.
Yeah, I think it's the trades that matter. The player, the movement is what matters on draft day, not who gets drafted where.
I'm just going to say most of these guys, just catch them on the D-League on YouTube when it streams. And
YouTube has great D-League broadcasts, Andrew, I think. I enjoy watching this.
And for the players that do play, if you want some priors, just wait till the preseason because summer league ball is just not even NBA basketball.
That's true.
All right, Brian, anything? I'll let you get the last word, and then I'll be out, or at least I can head out. You guys can stick around if you want.
Patrick and Andrew, how are you guys doing? Are you ready to... you know, retreat to your solitary draft watching, or do you want to keep going? I mean, chat is lit. We have like 9 people in chat still.
Stop, it's man. Lit. You're making it embarrassing.
So lit.
No, I'm honestly excited. This is great.
Yeah, usually when I'm in Twitch chat, I'm by myself. So 9 people.
Yeah. Well, Patrick, you probably want to go to work, but if you guys want to keep talking, I am down.
I don't want to go to work. I am at work, but I don't
know. No, go home from work.
No, I can stay on for a little bit longer.
Okay, maybe a few more picks, guys. And Dre, we'll have a good night.
All right, I'm going to stop roasting in my office. You guys have a good one.
All right.
See you later.
I'm going to keep roasting in my office. I'm having a good time.
So, sorry, who's on the clock right now?
All right, let's bring it up here.
I want to hear Patrick's thoughts on the Atlanta trade.
I actually don't really I don't really understand why Atlanta felt the need to trade a starting caliber guy for a pick. That doesn't. I mean, I don't know. Maybe they're going to start moving into full-blown rebuilding mode, but I don't really understand why. I thought from Utah's perspective, it's good, right? George Hill's a good starting caliber point guard, and that was their biggest weakness. So I like it from Utah's perspective. I think from Atlanta's perspective, it's kind of weird. And I think from Indiana's perspective, it's shuffling deck chairs. Like, I think... I mean, Hill and Teague are different types of players, but in terms of overall productivity, they're probably pretty similar.
And I also, and it makes the Atlanta trade even worse when you just realize that Teague is going to expire after next season. So you could have just sat.
What about Hill?
I think he's expiring next season too.
So they just traded one guy for another expiring guy. I'm not really sure why. I feel like the number 12 pick for a good point guard, even if he's
who did they did they even take who did they take with the number 12?
That's a good point. Who did Atlanta take?
Oh, we have that here. We can look this up for you guys. We'll do it live.
What?
I'm getting all these four. They took Taurean Prince out of Baylor, a senior.
So wow. Here's a tweet that I'm looking at that is verified. From AP Sports, according to an AP source, the 76ers offered Noel Covington and numbers 24 and number 26 for Chris Dunn.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
And the Timberwolves turned them down. And the only thing I can think of is, I think it makes sense to turn that down if you honestly believe you're really in the running to get Jimmy Butler and you need Chris Dunn to make that happen. That makes sense. But from a pure value perspective, it's absurd to turn.
They took Chris Dunn for the Bulls.
I don't think they took Chris Dunn for the Bulls, but they're in talks with the Bulls. They feel like they're close, and those talks would fall apart if they were to trade Dunn. So that's the only reason I could think of to turn a trade like that down. Because from a pure value perspective, that would be a great deal, right?
Oh, Above the God says if we stop the show, he's going to leave his house to buy food. And yeah, well, you should buy food, but, you know, just scrounge what you have in the house. That's fine.
He's like scrounging in his cupboard with some old coffee beans.
Yeah, those are tasty. Those are good.
Pick yourself a PB&J, man. Just make
I got some cashews and some old gone up coffee beans.
Make a struggle bowl of cereal, man.
Oh, we've got our second look at Boston's war room here. They look very subdued, actually.
They're probably trying to look busy.
No, they're just all watching ESPN like we are, I think.
Have you guys seen the image that... apparently ESPN had a little segment on elite point guards during the draft coverage.
Oh, and interesting.
On the graphic are Damian Lillard, John Wall, Russell Westbrook, Kyrie Irving, Chris Paul, Kyle Lowry, Isaiah Thomas, the guy Kemba Walker and Jeff Teague.
So not Steph Curry is what you're saying.
Who's missing?
I was gonna say.
Okay. He was terrible in the finals, right? So he's finished. His career is done.
He was terrible relative to his.
They probably still hating on him because of those ugly shoes.
Oh well, I mean, like Bill Simmons, he said, "I'm a dad, so I love these dad shoes." The older people love those shoes. Love those Curry shoes.
There are better dad shoes you can wear. Get some Stan Smiths.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
And the quintessential dad shoe is the gray New Balances.
Oh, I have those. Even though I'm not a dad, I'm old. I love the gray New Balances. Great shoes. New Balance. Yeah, New Balance. Very comfortable, very cheap, like very practical shoe. Not cool at all.
I'm just waiting to see what future Hall of Famer that the San Antonio Spurs are going to draft.
There's a rumor. Oh, go ahead, Patrick.
They have the 29th pick, I'm assuming?
Yeah, 29th.
There's a rumor that they were looking to trade up a few weeks ago, that they had targeted someone that they wanted to take.
I think they might have been boosting like a lie. I think they might have been putting out a lie. Because a lot of teams are doing that around this time of the year. They put out little stuff like that.
I will say that Greg Popovich did coach with Don Nelson Sr. back in the day, and he was known as being one of the biggest liars in the draft that would put out all this misinformation. So maybe some of that rubbed off on him.
Yeah, they do that, and then they have this post hoc stuff where they go like, "Well, we worked that guy out, and we loved him, but we just didn't pull the plug on it." It's just like, whatever. I'm tired of reading pieces like that.
That's funny. Now, so were they involved with George Hill originally, or I'm trying to remember how that went down? Because does he have a Spurs alumni thing, or is he always on the Pacers? I can't remember. Anyway,
don't know. And meanwhile, all of the Brexit stuff is going down to the wire here.
Oh, is that votes tonight? Oh, wow.
Well, I think it's already done, right? Given the time difference, but
so it was this morning for us, then night for them. So they're counting it right now. It's not just starting now.
Apparently the vote is ridiculously close.
That's what the polls have been saying. Hmm. Any thoughts on the Brexit?
Rich, I keep seeing Yabusele out of France.
Oh,
going to Boston. Yabusele.
Okay, the Timberwolves just tweeted out a picture of their social media war room, and it's just four random white folks sitting around a meeting table.
They should, like,
that's how most meeting rooms are. It's a room full of white people. Just
I know, right? It's like
they should make them pose at least, shouldn't they? Like huddle around talking or like crunching numbers or something.
At least look busy.
At least
four folks in a very large room, so the room looks pretty empty.
Gotta have a big room to be a war room.
So the Celtics have drafted. I cannot pronounce the guy they have drafted.
Gershon
Yabusele?
Yes.
That's not even a person. You can't tell me that's a person.
Seems like a generated NBA 2K name.
Yeah, exactly. That's not a real guy.
It's like when you're in year five of your franchise mode and it's just random names coming in.
Gershon Yabusele?
Yabusele.
What if he's related to Yuta Tabuse, the great Japanese player? Probably not. They're showing some highlights, though. Look, he's rejecting these guys in the European leagues.
I think that's one resource that is starting to get tapped into more, but it's not tapped into a lot. It's the international. It's a high level of competition. I just don't think that resource is getting tapped into enough.
Well, he played for the French national team 2 years, they're saying. So, hey, that's something. That's, you know, good experience. But at the same
time...
And then if you go to
Real GM, they do have numbers for some of those leagues.
Mm. In fact, I don't know if you remember this, Patrick, but I remember at some point Wages of Wins folks were trying to look at those leagues and kind of compare them to the NCAA and, like, put a number in there and say... How can we weight these leagues?
I think Arturo did that. That preview in 2014.
That sounds right.
Yeah, he did it that year, and it was like the ACB was the second best league behind the NBA, which I can believe because like Real and Barca. I can believe that.
There's a lot of international players on ESPN's best available board right now. That's interesting. We're getting past like the American seniors.
So, Brian, what's the best available on that spreadsheet?
Oh, it's all the same guys. It's all the small school guys, like we were talking about. Walk up from Stephen F. Austin. Well, not a small school guy, but Collsworth from Brigham Young, the old guy, and Warney from Stony Brook. And these guys have been getting some talk. IPFW has a guy. Let's bring this up on screen here. John Conchar. But, I mean, so actually one thing I wanted to ask Dre is he kind of sorted out a lot of the small school guys on the post that he made on the website today. So I'm kind of wondering how he did that. But in terms of bigger school guys, Bryce Johnson from North Carolina is up there as one of the top guys. Also, Gary Payton from Oregon State is really high
up. But he's old. A lot of people, his knock is that he's old.
That's yeah,
that he's getting. He's like 24, so he's like the age of a second year NBA player.
Yeah. Well, so actually, I want to ask you this question, Patrick. I asked Andrew and Dre earlier before you came on. Is what do you think about old age players? Because if we're looking under the lens of we care about them for their rookie contract and that's it. Why wouldn't you want an older player to play better during their rookie contract? Or is that the wrong way to think about it?
That is the wrong. So I mean, you would. In an ideal world, a player would be amazing right from the get-go. In the ideal world, you want Chris Paul, right? Because then you you got 4 years to get value from a player. So the better they are in those 4 years, the more
so
value.
So he was young and really good in college.
Yeah.
He was. I think he was a junior, right? Was he?
Was he? I thought he was a sophomore or freshman.
I thought it was a sophomore. I think he was.
Maybe
a sophomore.
Yeah, it's sophomore. He wasn't a freshman. I remember that.
He was 20. He was 20. So he was he was fairly young.
And obviously, especially at the point guard position, he's an extremely rare case where he just right out of the get go is amazing, right? Or you know, Karl Anthony Towns is another example, a guy who's pretty much winning you games from day one, and especially you want that player who's going to have a really good rookie season, because in general the biggest leap a lot of players make is between years one and two, for various reasons. But I think. The thing with seniors, the thing that people worry about is not, or at least I hope there's some rational thinking going on here. It's not they're worried about like their ceiling or their potential or whatever. You know, what they're worried about is, okay, you're 24 years old and you're playing against 19-year-olds. You should be dominating. So how much does that domination really mean? That's the thing. Like, if you played basketball yourself, there's a huge difference between a 24-year-old and a 19-year-old.
Yeah. And
a 24-year-old who's not as good at as basketball can still dominate a 19-year-old who might, just for physical reasons or reverse. Like, you can have a 24-year-old who doesn't have that athleticism, but he can dominate a 19-year-old just because he's smarter and he knows how to play better. But all of that disappears once you go into the NBA, because that age disparity is not there anymore. So when you're looking at seniors, you want to make sure why are they dominating? Are they dominating just because they're either A, physically so much more gifted, or B, because they have like 4 years of basketball experience under their belt and are outplaying their physically more superior opponents? Either of those conditions would be big red flags in the NBA, right? So,
all right, can I play devil's advocate? What if he was consistently great versus, I mean, like a guy like Ken Faried versus a guy like Buddy Hill, who increasingly got better, but he was older. So I think that's more damning than the consistently great player that was great in college.
I agree, and I haven't looked at Walkup's numbers beyond this year, but
I think he only played 2 years. He's only played 2 years.
To see the guy, he transferred into junior college or something.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's like completely dominated his conference and the thing that about it too is like, it's not just in any one category. It's like across the board in every category: shooting, rebounding, assists, passing, etc. So it feels like he's worth a flyer for sure.
And there was another guy on his team a couple last year, I think, Jacob Walker, who was underrated. I think he should have got at least a D League offer.
Yeah.
Because there's also a D League draft, which you could also game the system, because a lot of teams are starting to have like 1-to-1 affiliations now.
Mm-hmm.
And in the future, it's going to be 30 D League teams, and I think the draft. I think you should do away with the D League draft and just make the draft longer, and you can game the system like baseball does with its minor league system.
Yeah, I mean,
even though I'm not in favor of a draft, period. But go ahead.
Yeah, so I just think in general, to get back to the topic, like the thing about the seniors is you have to have a very good idea of why that senior was dominating in college. And if, you know, like I said, if it's because they just keep getting better from year to year and they're dominating across the board, then maybe that's a sign of, okay, yeah, maybe he should have been drafted earlier and maybe he'll keep progressing along that line. But if it's a sign of like, well, from an athletic standpoint, he's pretty much the same guy he was at 19, but now he's a lot smarter at basketball, so he's outplaying all these 19-year-olds who are better athletes, then that's a big problem, because when you jump to the NBA, there aren't any dumb 19-year-olds to play against. And then vice versa, if like, okay, he hasn't really gotten any better at basketball, but now he's 24, so he's bigger and muscular than all his 19-year-old opponents. Again, that's a problem, because you jump to the NBA where everybody's big and strong and like you. So if either of those are the case, those are the big red flags. And I think you can do that. You can, you know, just kind of look at numbers, but it's probably an area where you really need that old school scouting to help you out. And try to have a knowledgeable coach actually try to help you figure out, okay, this guy is a senior, he's really great, he dominated his college opponents, but why?
And no, that's a great point, Patrick. Like, I want to point this out to the 8 remaining viewers, is we don't think, like, box score set. No, this is our, like, all-time high. That's a great number.
Stop it, man!
We don't think that, you know, wins produced needs to replace old-school scouting. What we think is basically that's, you know, we tell the scouts what they should scout for, right? Things like rebounding, efficient shooting, not just points per game. And so it's really kind of the, you know, the what, the how, and the why, right? It's a better way to look at it. It's like the beginning of the conversation, not the end.
And then from like a probability standpoint, whether you go with the old school scout or you just go strictly with a model, it's hard to do. Predictions are hard. It's just random stuff. So it's just hard to do.
And we do have breaking news, by the way. Memphis Grizzlies take Wade Baldwin IV. I don't know if being the fourth in a legacy is better than being the second, like Gary Payton.
He played. He played on the same team with Carl Anthony Towns in high school.
Oh, interesting. Interesting.
Yeah. And I watched this one game where Carl Anthony Towns' high school team played against Ben Simmons' team.
Wow.
That was a really good game. You had D'Angelo Russell in that game too. And that's crazy for a high school game, but
4 future NBA players minimum.
Yeah.
Maybe more later on.
I wanted to also bring up the player that we liked in 2014, I think. Was it 2014? Jordan Adams. He's had a lot of injury problems. And that's another thing that you have to throw into evaluating is that medical evaluations. And like Kevon Looney has had prior to last year's draft, he had like a hip injury or something, and now he's having to have another surgery this offseason. So you just never.
That's okay. I believe in Kevon Looney, a Pac-12 great.
You just never know what you're gonna get.
I mean, yeah, for every Shaq and Tim Duncan, there's like a Sam Bowie and Greg Oden, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like it's really hard to predict these kinds of things too. Like, if you asked me 3 years ago, I think all of us were not very high on Golden State because we were like, Steph Curry is just a walking ambulatory station, right? He's never going to be healthy. And then he played like 2 seasons of Iron Man basketball, 3 seasons now. I think that it's really hard to like draw conclusions based on, and sometimes people have lots of freak injuries in a row and it doesn't necessarily indicate any medical problem. It's just freak luck, right?
And ironically, Curry got hurt at the very end after these Iron Man seasons to cost
the finals. Yeah, well, and if you look at the way he got hurt, it wasn't because he has a frail body. I mean, that was just a freak thing, the way he slipped on a...
Fluke or deliberate, maybe that should be a new move to put sweat behind the good players as they're backing up.
I do got to say, that player, I'm trying to remember who it was.
It was someone on the Rockets, right? It was one of their bad bench guys.
Muntz-Yunus, I think.
Muntz-Yunus. It was Muntz-Yunus.
He fucking slipped. He was like fucking playing water sled or something. Like, he was slipping everywhere all the fucking time. I was like, dude, stand the fuck up. Yeah. Stop ruining the careers of all these players. Yeah, he was dangerous to be around.
I've got breaking news from chat, by the way, from Above the Gods and Ziano61. The polls are closed. Levy U was leading, but Romaine took the lead.
I've been watching it for like an hour. It gets going back and forth like crazy. It's insane. It's super close. I hear though that I think that they've counted like almost all the ones in Scotland where people suspect that the Romaine vote is higher.
Really, in Scotland? That's interesting.
Maybe it's the other way around. Actually, I don't know. I just know every time I check, it's like flip flop.
Henry Ellison is going to Detroit.
Oh yeah, let's get his. We're on the Nuggets stats here. Yeah.
Wait, who's going to Detroit?
Ellison, Henry Ellison.
At this point in the draft, I honestly don't care if it's not a trade. Then
it's
not interesting for me.
So we're probably starting to wind down then. Are there any picks we want to stay for? Are we ready to head out, guys?
I think I got to head out, actually.
Yeah. You need to get home and eat.
I can just catch who San Antonio drafts later.
Above the Gods
needs
to eat.
It's going to be like an hour from
now. Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to watch the draft. I'm just going to watch Twitter or whatever.
Yeah. There we go.
That's the way to do it.
Well, let's take it out then, guys. This has been a lot of fun. like I was saying earlier, I wasn't ready for the draft, but now that we're into it, I'm having a good time. And boy, if Patrick Fierce sake, I hope that Jimmy Butler comes through.
Yeah, I'm crossing my fingers.
this has been fun. It's been fun.
His last two. Hopefully, it's for Jimmy Butler, not to get rid of Rubio for random guys, right?
Well, maybe they can call up Philadelphia and do that trade again if the
Bulls
trade falls through.
All right, so let's do any parting words. It doesn't have to be shout-outs, just anything. Patrick, do you want to go first? Do you have anything to say or no? Are you good?
I got nothing to say, no. Thanks Andrew, for letting me join at the last minute.
Nah, all right, guys. I said everything, so I'm good.
Awesome. No, that was fun, and enjoy the rest of the draft. Thanks, chat, for joining along. That was a lot of fun. Let's turn it off. All right, bye, guys.
All right.